The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. While some people were speaking about how the temple was adorned with costly stones and votive offerings, Jesus said, "All that you see here, the days will come when there will not be left a stone upon another stone that will not be thrown down." Then they asked him, "Teacher, when will this happen? And what sign will there be when all these things are about to happen?" He said, See that you not be deceived, for many will come in my name, saying, 'I am he,' and 'the time has come.' Do not follow them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for such things must happen first. But it will not immediately be the end." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be powerful earthquakes, famines, and plagues from place to place, and awesome sights and mighty signs will come from the sky. Before all this happens, however, they will seize and persecute you. They will hand you over to the synagogues and to prisons, and they will have you led before kings and governors because of my name. It will lead to you giving testimony. Remember, you are not to prepare your defense beforehand, for I myself shall give you a wisdom in speaking that all your adversaries will be powerless to resist or refute. You will even be handed over by parents, brothers, relatives, and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair on your head will be destroyed. By your perseverance, you will secure your lives." The Gospel of the Lord. When is the world going to end? I've had individuals ask me that question, giving various circumstances. This is a question that arises even throughout history. Of course, our Lord does give certain predictors. He does speak about how there will be one nation against another, so times of war, earthquakes, famines, plagues. There will be awesome sights, persecution, even persecution within our own family. But we do not know. I think of my own lifetime. So back when I was in kindergarten, St. Bernadette's grade school, it was the Cuban Missile Crisis. And we had to bring food to school in case Washington would be attacked. We practiced hiding under our desks, like that would do a lot of good with a nuclear blast. But there you have it. And the world, some people in the world were like the prophets who said, quoting Malachi, "This is the prophecy, like the blazing oven, this nuclear war is going to come down and consume us." Well, we're all still here. Some of you may remember Y2K. So we're all concerned about the year 2000. And of course, the news media is talking about how the computers will shut down and the air traffic will shut down and the electrical grid will be destroyed and all these kinds of things. So New Year's Eve at my other parish, Queen of Apostles, 11 o'clock, we had a special mass. Mass concluded right about at midnight, and we all were in silence. And all of a sudden, the big church bell rang, bong, bong, bong. Did anything happen? No. We're still here. And of course, I will say, too, that in the year 2017, I was a little spiritually spooked because it was 100 years after the apparitions of Our Lady of Fatima. And I thought, well, maybe if our Lord's going to come again, and we're going to call this quits, better be ready. We're still here. So the point is, we need to be prepared spiritually, but we do not live in fear. On the other hand, though, we should not be seduced into some kind of complacency. Our Lord talks about the temple and how there will be at some point when the temple will be destroyed. And the Jewish people could not believe that. They thought, how is this going to happen? For them, the temple, God's holy house in Jerusalem, was their security. God would always protect them. They had forgotten, though, that 600 years earlier, the Babylonians had come and destroyed that temple. It was rebuilt. Well, we go fast forward ahead. Year 70, the Jews decide to revolt against Rome. Fatal mistake. Vespasian, the emperor, sends his nephew, Titus Florus, with the 9th Legion. They surrounded Jerusalem, starved it out, crucified anyone trying to leave. When the city surrendered, they went in and destroyed it and flattened the temple. That's why we only have the Wailing Wall. So the key here, too, is we should not be complacent, thinking, oh, everything is just fine and dandy. So with that all said, what should we do? Well, our Lord tells us at the end of the gospel today, he says, by your perseverance, you will secure your lives. A better translation of that would be, by your patient endurance, you will secure your souls. Think of that. Our souls. It's who we are. The soul is immortal. It lives on beyond this body. So it's the who we are. So even if we're living in all these different circumstances, which at times may frighten us, and we think, is this going to be the end of the world? Who knows? So be it. Inside, in our soul, we can find peace. We can secure our lives if we're living with the Lord each day. And that's really the key. To live with the Lord each day and find that peace of soul. So every morning, I would encourage you to give a kiss to the Lord. Now, K-I-S-S-S, because for me, it's an anagram. Keep it simple, silent, and steadfast. Consider, so oftentimes, we complicate our lives. We overextend ourselves, taking on too many responsibilities, even good ones, but too many. We may overextend our financial obligations, which causes great stress. We may overextend ourselves in many ways, even being comfortable with sin. So what we need to do is simplify. Live simply in how we use the things of this world, how we live our lives spiritually. Wouldn't life be much more simple if we just followed fully the Ten Commandments? If we were always truthful? If we were always just in dealing with others? If we were always trying to be kind and generous and so on? If we really lived simply as our Lord wants us to live, think how better life would be. Secondly, we need to also have silence. We live in a world where it's like constant noise, not just the radio or the television, but think of the computers, whatever source it may be. Statistics, surveys show that the average American spends 9 hours a day on screen time. Well, granted, we all have to do that in some extent, whether schoolwork, regular work, and the like, but does that possess us then? Are we constantly trying to respond immediately to the message, to the text, to the email? Or are we always trying to keep up with what's going on in Facebook and things like that? So much that our life becomes noisy. So it's a very noisy kind of life. Instead, we need time for silence, to take time to be alone with the Lord and rest with Him. To offer our regular prayers and other devotions, we need to express our life to Him, asking for help in whatever way we need, giving thanks for all that we have. That will simplify our lives. To pray for those that we love or others that we know in need, to express sorrow for our sins. But that silent time then will overflow, so that even if we're in those difficult periods of the day, when things get stressful, we can always go back inside and find the presence of the Lord. We then, too, need to be steadfast. Each day is a new day. We start by getting out of the bed. We live it. We don't know what's going to happen each day, but we're steadfast. We commit ourselves to following Christ. And we also try as best we can to be that faithful disciple. We keep plugging along day after day, rather than living a life of chaos, getting out of bed and just starting to be like, I'm going to have to put out all these fires today. And it's like one thing after the other. No plan of life, just one thing after the other, one reaction after the other. No, we have to be steadfast. So, that kiss to the Lord each day, to keep it simple, silent, steadfast, rather than trying to complicate our life, to allow the noise to take over, to live in chaos. Granted, it is a struggle, no question, but each day is a new day. The real key here is we know that one day this world does end. Maybe not the world, but our world, we die. But if we have that security of our soul, that peace of soul, we have no fears. Yes, we will leave here. Our soul leaves here. Who we are leaves here. And we face Almighty God. We know we have to give an account. But if our soul is filled with grace, that peace, then our Lord will embrace us and welcome us into his kingdom. Even if we go from this life with those little venial sins, with the hurts caused by sin that have not been healed, our Lord in his love will heal us, purge us, forgive us, purify us in that hospital we call purgatory. But then, eventually, we will be embraced by the Lord in heaven. But if we leave here with that soul that is so laid down from all the complications, all the noise, all the chaos of living life without the Lord, that's what hell's about. It's sort of like we live hell now, life without the Lord, and that just continues on to eternity. So my brothers and sisters, as we celebrate this Sunday, looking ahead to next Sunday, the Feast of Christ the King, which ends our liturgical year, take time today, this week, to pause and think about the kiss, keeping it simple, silent, and steadfast. Mother Teresa always said that yesterday has gone, it's in the past. Tomorrow has not yet come, do not worry. Live in the present, live in the present love of Christ, and he will be with us each day, every day, and he will walk with us through life, no matter what life holds. May God bless you.